Yeah, okay. Hey, hi. My name is Michael. I'll be sharing with us a little bit about Cloud Foundry. Okay. Cloud Foundry. That's me, Michael Cheng. I work at Singapore Power, not Powers. Anyway, so what is Cloud Foundry? So I think just a quick overview of what IT has kind of become, like traditional IT as we know it has, uses. You basically have to deal with infrastructure, storage, compute, and runtime. And before you even talk about data and applications, that's traditional IT, right? And then things like Amazon came along and turned the whole thing into like virtual environments and everything. And now we have infrastructure as a service. Basically, you only need to bring your runtime and middleware, and the Amazons of the world will just deal with the hardware. Basically, they have virtual machines that you can load your stuff into. So the more recent development is platform as a service. So basically, you manage just the data and your applications. So that's kind of like where Heroku is right now. How many guys are using Heroku? Oh, right, yeah. So that's kind of like where Heroku is in a way. So you bring your own data, and you bring your data, and upload your applications, and that's it. It's all there, right? So that's the Cloud Foundry evolution over the years. So what is platform as a service, right? So the Wikipedia definition is that it's a category of cloud computing services, which provides a platform that allows you guys, the developers, to develop and run and manage applications without the complexity of building up the infrastructure and all that stuff. So it's basically about deploying stuff, right? So basically, it's other people's server, and they maintain it, and you deploy your code and data. So platform as a service is broadly separated into two types. There are public things like in the public cloud, things like Heroku, Google App Engine, Red Hat's OpenShift, Elastic Beanstalk. These are kind of like platform as a service for public clouds. And then you have private clouds, basically stuff you can host in-house. Basically, the stuff you can put in your own data centers in your own company. So basically, for things like you have, for example, you have data compliance, you need to have privacy compliance, you need to have, because of these reasons, you need to have it all in your own data center. So this is where a private cloud and platform as a service like Cloud Foundry will be helpful for you. So that's Cloud Foundry. There's also other solutions out there such as OpenShift, Bluemix, there's other such as Days and Doku, which I'll also talk a little bit about later. What is Cloud Foundry? Basically, it's an open source platform service software. So basically, you can use this to develop and run cloud applications, and these are kind of like 12-factor apps that you build. Also, a lot of Rails app that we have could be deployed into a 12-factor app. Cloud Foundry is a lot like Heroku. So it basically can work in many languages and frameworks. It allows you to automatically provision your resources. So basically, you can use a command line and say, I need a database server, I need Redis, I need RabbitMQ, and all provision for you, and you just deploy your app, and it knows about how to connect to all these other services. So it enables things like continuous integration and continuous delivery. So these are a short list of languages that are supported. So you can do Java on this. You can do Ruby, you can deploy JRuby, any rack type applications, Rails, even Sinatra apps, Node.js. You can upload a binary file, so things like Go can deploy on this as well. PHP, Python, and even static files, you can throw it up there. So we've talked about Cloud Foundry, so so currently there is a you can't you can get Cloud Foundry directly. Basically, you can just download Cloud Foundry from cloudfoundry.org, and you can try to install that in your data center. But it tends to be rather the open source version of Cloud Foundry. Let me just show you the website. So it's Cloud Foundry. So you can see all these other companies that are supporting it right now. And yeah, so IBM is here. So if any of you guys uses IBM Bluemix? No? So IBM Bluemix is a flavor of Cloud Foundry. Yeah, just saying. So you can get a lot of these things. You can download this and basically use it in your data center. But it tends to be rather tricky to install because there's from ops perspective, there's actually not a straightforward process of installing this. You basically need to use something called Bosch. So we're familiar with configuration management for your server side. My internet is kind of slow. Anyway, yeah, so basically open source version of Cloud Foundry can be installed, but it's rather difficult to do it. You can do it, but it's going to take some time, and documentation is quite comprehensive. But yeah, there's an easier way. So the easier way is actually go with one of the reference implementation like Pivotal Cloud Foundry or IBM Bluemix. So with this reference implementation, they actually made a lot of additional software on top of Cloud Foundry that makes it a lot easier to install Cloud Foundry in your data center. So Pivotal Cloud Foundry is basically the open source version plus and builds on top of it additional services and enterprise services and features. First of all, PCF is much easier to install. It has for example, if you really install Cloud Foundry, you probably have to deal with a bunch of configuration files which are YAML based. And these configuration files can run up to thousands of lines of code. With Pivotal Cloud Foundry, they include a thing called Ops Manager that lets you, with a web GUI, run the installation on all your servers. It also has a very nice web GUI that you can log in and, as a developer, maintain your and scale up your app and all that stuff. There are other additional features like LDAP support. There's some metric servers that you can throw in. And out of the box, it also comes pre-installed with things like Neo4j, RabbitMQ, Redis, and so on and so forth. Like in Sigma Power, we actually got that PCF installed, and we have like Postgres, Redis, RabbitMQ, and a few of these other services already bundled together. This is a quick chart of a graph from their website that tells you about the difference between the open source version and the commercial version. It's quite a few things there. But if you want to experience Pivotal Cloud Foundry now, there's an easy way, which is basically go to their hosted version. They call it Pivotal Web Services, PWS. So you use this to basically test out Pivotal Cloud Foundry. And if you feel that it's something that you would like to have in your enterprise, you can try this as well. So you can register for a free trial account. It's like you go to run.pivotal.io. You can get that. This is how the website looks like. You can register for an account and you can claim a free trial, which is about $87 worth of credits. So the way that PCF works is that it organizes your applications into organizations and workspaces. So organization could be like your IT departments or your accounting department and so on and so forth. And workspaces could be like development spaces, production spaces, and so on and so forth. So you can actually manage your ACL for basically everyone in your enterprise. So here's another chart of how we organize into organizations and spaces. It's a logical way of organizing users, basically. This is how it looks like when you're logged in. So all this is what you get with Pivotal Cloud Foundry. With PWS, they also provide you additional services like this, so you can try this out and kind of like, it's kind of like Heroku in a way. You know how Heroku works, it's pretty much similar to that. Even the deployment is very much like Heroku. It's in a way it uses build packs. So you use similar types of build packs that you get on Heroku. In fact, the build packs used for Cloud Foundry are actually forked from Heroku build packs. So it's very similar in a way. You can also interface with PCF using command line interface, very much like how you do it on Heroku. So you can download the PCF CLI here. You can also do a brew install for the Mac users. You can just do a brew install on this. You can also download from the web page. I'm supposed to do a demo now. Let's do this. Let me try and do a demo quickly. Oops. What the hell is that? Yeah, just see. Chris Bosh. He's a basketball player. Okay, I'm not familiar with him. Anyway, I'll try to log into my account now. You know what they say about live demos, right? They always fail where you need it the most. Internets, why you know works? Okay, I'm trying to be calm here. Right, not now. Okay, so it's logging me in. This is Pivotal Web Services, which is the hosted version of PCF. Okay. Right, so we upload stuff here. It basically lets you, you can attach services to this right now. So I say I want to attach a Postgres or MySQL or Postgres.
Elephant.
Okay, post. There you go. Right, I'll select a plan, give it a name. So I am using a little app that I wrote. It's a Rails app. Yeah, so, right. So I can go to the web page and, so basically it's the commands you can run to kind of like log in using a command line. And I could also create a service over here, but I'm going to try and create that right now with the web interface. So I create this PostgresDB. I don't have any applications yet. I will not bind it to anything. Development space. Cool. So that's done. Next, I need to push my local app to this guy. Before that, I need to actually log in on my command line, so let's do that too. Let's see, I'll log into this guy. Right. Cool. Yeah, so it's my personal account, so it's logged into that environment. So next thing I could do is try and push this up there somewhere. So yeah, I'll try to push this to a guestbook, and the host name is basically a subdomain that I add in front. So because this is probably demo.guestbook is probably quite a common name, so I just try to add something not so common, probably my name. So if you deploy stuff to Pivotal Cloud Foundry or PWS, you actually have a domain name that they give you, cfapps.io. So you can actually do that for your, you can attach any domain that you have for your own webs for your own installation as well. Right, so you can see here is picking up the build packs, the stuff that's needed there. Oops. No. Right, they upgraded their build pack recently and removed support for Ruby 2.3.1. This is rather embarrassing. Yeah, but you get that gist, right? You just push it up there, kind of like, you know, okay, I think I have a backup. Let me see. Do I have a screen? I didn't have the screen here. Damn it. Okay, fine. I used to have a screen here that shows you the full deployment. So once it's deployed, it works a lot like how you do stuff on Pivotal Cloud on Heroku. Okay, I wrote this app some time back, like earlier this year or middle of last year.
What happens if you just change the version and try to push?
You could. I could go for a lower version of the build pack. So I'm going to use this opportunity to show you the manifest file. So deployment manifest. So the main difference between PCF and Heroku is that uh, with With PCF or Cloud Foundry, you can create a manifest file, which you can declaratively set up how much RAM you need, how much what disk space you have, what services it's attached to, and even the build pack that you need, you can actually specify all that in the manifest file. And I'll try to show you the manifest file for mine. It's a very simple build pack like this. I can do CF build packs to show me, which will show me all the different build packs that are available. I wonder whether I can use a lower version of the build pack. I can do a quick search. If you don't even indulge me, I'll try and do a quick search of what is the last known build pack that supports 2.3.0. Right. Releases. So what we're using now is 2.1.6.30. Wow, okay. Ruby 2.3. Oh shit, okay, go for the back. Still have 1.6. Okay, let's try to get this one. I don't know, is that the correct one? Nope, not the right one. Shit, how did I change? Unfortunately, I'm not sure how to change to this one. Okay, I've not tried this before. Usually, if I have used a lower version of the build pack, I will tell my sysadmin and they will basically upload the build pack version. So, and if you look at, you can actually control what kind of build packs are there. In this case, these are the one that's given to you by, given to me by PWS. I could put in a URL for another build pack, but I haven't actually tried it before. Technically, you could find the right version behind. I have not tried it yet. I don't know whether I can upload my own custom build pack yet. So, essentially, yeah, I think I did a bad demo. I'm sorry. I apologize profusely. Anyway, so deployment manifest. So you can, as I said, there's a YAML file that lets you configure what kind of things that goes in. There is an example of, here's an example of what you can find on Bluemix. Bluemix gives you a very nice manifest generator that lets you create and specify the build pack. You can basically set all this up, memory, instance, number of instances and all that. You can scale it. Of course, you can do the scaling as well in the command line and even on the website. Another cool thing you can do is actually log into a app container. So basically, all apps are running in a Linux container. They're deployed as Linux containers. You can actually SSH into any of the running instances for your application. And then you can do a check on other files that you have deployed. Are they actually there? And so on and so forth. Another thing about Cloud Foundry is that it's not backed by Git. So you don't rely on Git to do deployment. Basically, when you do CF push, uses HTTP and uploads all your files on your local folder into the server. So you could actually do this deployment easily on a CI server like Jenkins or whatnot. So we actually have a Jenkins server that has a Cloud Foundry plugin where you can key in all the credentials and all that. It's all set there, and you will be able to basically upload the stuff for you. If you're deploying this in your enterprise and company, you probably have some legacy databases. And sometimes some of these legacy databases, you don't have proper support in Cloud Foundry. For you to work with those things, you can actually create user-provided services. Basically, it's to expose a service which can input things like login credentials to your legacy databases, which will then be exposed as environment variables to your applications. You can also create your own managed services for Cloud Foundry. So let's say, for example, you have your own data, you have your own systems with your own data sources. you can actually expose them to your applications that are hosted in Cloud Foundry. So basically, you basically let developers do self-service. The developers can say, I need this data, information from this legacy database, I need information from another legacy database. You can actually use either user-provided services and service brokers that you write to basically support those additional things. So that's pretty much it. I'm sorry, I did a very bad demo today. I should have been a bit more prepared. So, do you have any questions, guys?
So why do they remove support for certain versions and then screw their customers like you?
To encourage you to use the latest version. But then, to be fair, PWS is pretty... PWS, from Pivotal Cloud Foundry's perspective, PWS is kind of like the reference deployment for PCF. And they usually use the bleeding edge or the latest version of the of things. In Singapore Power, because we have PCF installed and we have full control over what goes in there, we could upload older versions of build packs, which has better support for other things, better support for older stuff that we have written. In a way, it encourages you to try to upgrade the latest version. So
yeah. They give you warning that it's being deprecated.
If your app is already deployed, there's probably no danger of that happening. But then again, all the build packs and all the information are actually open source. So you can actually follow those open source projects, or you can even just keep to an older version of the build packs. In this case, I don't actually have access to upload older build packs into PCF or the PWS, which is what I'm using now. But if you have it hosted in your own data center, you could potentially do that. Yes?
Can you change the tag in GitHub to be back on GitHub when you were trying to download the build pack?
Mm-hmm. Tag? Yeah, I could do that. So what was the one that... 1628? Was that the one?
Yeah,
that ready? Yep. Let me see whether I can... Can I just get this one? Oops, sorry. I can download the zip. Anyway, let me show you a little bit about the CF command line. So there's a whole bunch of things. There's a whole bunch of things you can do with the in the CF command line. So let's see CF help dash all. So basically, you can do things like set environment variables, check out your installed plugins locally. You can do other stuff like the security groups you can set up. You can manage services. Like service brokers would be things like your Redis or your Postgres databases that you're connected to. You can manage your space, your organization. You can look at the build packs. And so on and so forth. Can I create a build pack? Let's see what this command gives me. Sorry about that.
Is this because you pinned the Ruby version in the gem file? What if you just change that to 2.3?
I could also do that. Is it 2?
2, yeah.
Yeah. Things should work. Bundle. Oops. Should be okay. Let's try this again. See whether that works. Like this. Yay! Sorry. Thank you. That's rather embarrassing. Sorry about that.
Mike, what kind of, I might have missed this, but what kind of configuration management or orchestration tools is possible?
Configuration management in terms of what? No, you don't need this because you don't need Chef or Puppet or anything because you're not managing servers, you're deploying applications.
So how does it abstract this?
You basically deploy an app you're deploying an application only. You only deal with the application and data and the data sources that it connects to. The ops would be okay. So that's a good question. If you're using from an ops perspective, so my entire slides deck is mainly about a developer spec perspective. As a developer working with Cloud Foundry, your user experience is very much like how you use with Heroku. From an ops perspective, deploying this, the only way to deploy this Cloud Foundry is using a configuration management software called Bosch. Bosch conflates both configuration management and release management. So basically with Bosch, it actually manages the configuration of all the different virtual machines that Cloud Foundry needs to work with. It also versions the releases so that you can actually easily roll back to the older version if you need to. So basically you have configuration as code all managed in one giant YAML file in a way. Yeah. So there are a lot of community releases of for different things like Concourse, which is CI server, RabbitMQ, MySQL, and so on and so forth. So these are basically Bosch is the preferred configuration management tool used for deploying Cloud Foundry. So for deploying Cloud Foundry, depending on how you size it, it can take up to quite a lot of virtual machines. Because the way that it works is that it's scaled up in a way that you can easily deploy apps. And in a way, it helps developers who are working in an enterprise environment where you don't need to request for virtual machines anymore. Because as a developer, I just need to worry about deploying applications. Virtual machines are already deployed for you or provisioned for you as part of Cloud Foundry's release in a way. Yeah? Does that answer your question?
Yep, thanks.
Cool. All right, cool. Looks like it's deployed. Okay, let's try and look at the page. Something went wrong, mainly because I did not migrate the database. Haha. Surprise. So I can do this, hopefully. So basically I can run arbitrary commands here like rake db migrate and basically run it in that particular instance. Hopefully it works. It should work. I hope. In any case, I could actually show you right now if I do So if I do cfssh into Oh wait, it's deploying, okay. So there are a couple of ways of running arbitrary code on the server. So I've chosen one of the more destructive ways of doing it. Basically, I overwrite the people are familiar with Docker. How many of you guys have used Docker before? Right. So Docker has a run as a command that it runs, right? So I'm actually overwriting the default run command that the buildpad uses, and I'm replacing that with rakedb migrate. So after that, I will change back to just now, which will revert back to the original buildpack's version of the run command. So there are other ways that are recommended to do this. If you do migration on a regular basis, one of the ways for doing that is to use an additional rake task. So you can run a rake task as before you run Rails server. And the rake task will basically do the migration first. You basically look for the first instance of the Cloud Foundry app, run migration from that instance and then revert back to running Rails. So I've done that and I'm reverting it back to the default command, which is to run Rails server. And hopefully at the end of this, I should have an application running. So I can do other things like CF apps to show me what are the applications I have running right now, and services will show me the different services that are attached to my applications, and so on and so forth. There's a whole bunch of other things you can do with in the command line. Of course, one thing I want to show you is scf-ssh. Okay, app is running again. Let's CFSSH into my box. At the same time, I can try and reload the page. Yes! Running! Yay! Who says live demo is hard? It's very hard. Yeah, this is a very basic stuff. Yeah. Hello, back. Yep. Right, so on the right hand side, you see that I've actually logged into my application now. So I can look inside app. You can see my application is here. Right? Right, so yeah, that's all I have. Is there any questions? Any other questions? Yes.
So how did it do service discovery? How do you know like what, where your Postgres?
Right, so when you attach a service to your application, it exposes certain environment variables like database URL, and then you can kind of make sure your application uses those environment variables. Of course, you need to also attach an app. So in this case, if you look at my manifest file, actually tells me I need to attach myself to a service. And the service is called PostgresDB, which you saw me create when I first log into the web app, web interface, right?
And what would be the environment variable like? Because I'm curious, like for a case where let's say you have two PostgresDB, one for one that is a master and the other is a slave.
I think it will be okay. So when you do CF env guest book. You can see all the different environment variables that were exposed to this guy. There is another environment variable called vcap. It's a JSON file. So it's a JSON string rather. So you can see this here. And inside here, there has an Elephant SQL, which is the SQL database that we connected to. And you can see it's actually an array. So if you attach more than one, you can actually look into this and iterate through the arrays and find the correct exact one. Of course, there are also specific environment variables that are only there for this instance. So if I try to log into my guestbook again, this is one good thing that with Cloud Foundry that you can shell into your running instance and actually inspect things inside there, such as your environment. So in my environment with env, I can see all the environments that are actually there. So it's basically kind of like a running Linux box here, in a way, except it's a container. Okay, cool. Yeah.
What else were you comparing it to?
Right. So I was also comparing it to these other things. Days. So if you're trying to install something, you really like containers. So Days is one of those other solutions out there, which lets you, basically it's backed by Kubernetes. So you use Kubernetes to deploy applications, and it also uses Buildpacks to do deployment. These are the companies that are actually behind this right now. And if you also, another option out there is called Doku. Basically, it's like Heroku, but everything in it's like Heroku, but only for one machine. It's also backed by Docker. And I don't recommend this for production. It's probably good for toy projects that you're working on. It uses build packs as well. So it uses exact same build packs that you can find on Heroku. But it's a good way to kind of like test out stuff. Like for example, on Heroku, your file system is unstable, for example. With Doku, you can actually deploy a rail set that uses SQLite, and basically will be a rather safe and stable deployment. And it's also backed by Docker, so you can actually couple this with additional Docker containers that you can just expose to these applications that you deploy here. So basically, it's kind of like they think about how can I deploy a pass with just bash scripts. So basically, this is what they came up with. So you use build packs, deploy with build packs, and installation is fairly straightforward. Yeah, it's good for testing. I wouldn't recommend it for production. You could try. We do have certain services that we're playing with that's running on Doku. In the early days, before we had Cloud Foundry installed, we were using Doku for some of the test applications that we were deploying. Yeah, so. Something you can look into. One of the things that I don't like about Doku right now is that, for example, you have environment variable which is multi-line. Like say you have some private key that you need to include. Doku doesn't have a proper way of letting you store multi-line environment variables, which kind of sucks, right? So at least with Cloud Foundry, I can actually include the multi-line YAML, environment variables in the YAML file, right? Which lets me push those data up. Okay. Personally, I'm more experienced with Doku than Daze. Daze is backed by Kubernetes. So if you're interested in, you already have some investments in Kubernetes and you want an easier way for your developers to deploy apps, this could be an option for you guys to consider. And basically, if you have full control, you still have all the scaling capabilities and management capabilities that Kubernetes gives you, which can be an advantage if you're running services or they are already using Kubernetes. Is it okay?
Thank you.
Okay. So once again, we're hiring. So that's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you.